want to mention today, simply before we continue, that this is especially an appropriate remembrance on the 100th anniversary of the beginning of the Battle of Vimy Ridge, because we too need to remember that the dark road of suffering and death is only 100 years old for a number of young Canadians a few years ago, and that we will continue to remember that sacrifice and suffering that does in fact remind us of what Jesus went through and reminds us that the road through suffering and death to new possibilities is one that should be fresh in our memory. So just pause for a moment to remember those youngsters who lost their lives in the invasion and then they'll continue. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, Lord God, of our salvation, that we may enter with joy into the celebration of those mighty acts whereby you give us life and immortality through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately send them." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowd that went ahead of him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him a name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born.
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
Jesus replied,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said,
"Take, eat, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Though all become deserters, because of you, I will never desert you."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times."
Peter said to him,
"Even though I must die with you, I will never deny you."
And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want."
Then Jesus came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
"So, could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again he went away for the second time and prayed,
"My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done."
Again Jesus came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
"The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him."
At once Judas came up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi."
And Judas kissed him. Jesus said to him,
"Friend, do what you are here to do."
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this is taking place so that the scriptures and the prophets may be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said,
"This fellow said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.
The high priest stood up and said,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him,
"You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard of his blasphemy. What is your verdict?"
They answered,
"He deserves death."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying,
"Prophesy to us, he's Messiah, who is this destroying you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said,
"You also were with Jesus the Galilean."
But Peter denied it before all of them, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw Peter, and she said to the bystanders,
"This man was with Jesus."
Again, he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"Certainly, you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you."
Then Peter began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know the man."
At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said,
"Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times.
And Peter went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. He said,
"I have sinned by betraying innocent blood."
But they said,
"What is that to us? See to it yourself."
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
"It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money."
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah,
"And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom the price had been set, on whom some the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them the harvest field as the Lord commanded me."
Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him,
"Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him."
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
And they said,
"Barabbas."
Pilate said to them,
"Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called Messiah?"
All of them said,
"Let him be crucified."
Then Pilate asked,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Let him be crucified."
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourself."
And the people as a whole answered,
"His blood be on us, not on our children."
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. Please stand. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself, you who are the Son of God, come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to, for he said,
I am God's son."
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?"
That is,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"This man is calling for Elijah."
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him."
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies. bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, many women were also there looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive.
After 3 days, I will rise again.
Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people.
He had been raised from the dead.
And the last deception would be worse than the first.
Pilate said to them,
You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can.
So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone.
May only God's word be spoken, and only God's word be heard. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, God's living word. stain of sin, you would probably look to religious traditions of your own. In particular, you would look to the Exodus, to the time when each family, imprisoned as slaves in Egypt, would slaughter a lamb, put blood of the lamb on the doorpost, would thereby be saved from the visitation of the angel of death, and then would be led out of slavery into a journey that would culminate in a land promised by God to their ancestor Abraham. So, if I were a person at this time, from that religious tradition, I would think of Jesus and his death in those terms. The lamb who was slaughtered for our sake. And indeed, in the early liturgies of the church, which we still use today, we say things like, O Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. And indeed, that's one understanding of the redemptive power of this story. Paul offers another one, slightly different one, because Paul is writing after the Easter event. And one understanding that he offers links to that Passover story. Paul suggests that in baptism, we die with Christ, to be raised to new life with Christ. That our baptism is some of what this transforming story is about. And indeed, in our baptismal liturgies, you'll find clear reference to the Passover, to the people of Israel being baptized in a way as they pass through the Red Sea, as they have new life in a new land open before them. And indeed, that's clearly a theme and a somewhat different sense of what the crucifixion partly means. All of those focuses, of course, tend to be on personal sin and personal redemption, personal new life in Christ. In later years, as people learn more about the historical and social and political context in which these events took place, they bring to their understanding of this story some different perspectives. For example, there are theologians who make the case that part of the truth of Palm Sunday is that as Jesus was entering Jerusalem by the Eastern Gate in a kind of triumphal procession with coats and palm leaves, riding a donkey, that because of the Passover that was about to take place, the Roman governor would be riding his white horse coming into the western gate of Jerusalem, accompanied not by shouts of Hosanna, but by those sort of bugle sounds that went with Roman armies and banners, not palm leaves, and soldiers marching noisily on the pavement. And that gives us another understanding of what's happening in this story. And indeed, there is evidence of it even in the Gospel account, where Jesus is not simply creating a kind of redemption for individuals, although that's part of it, but Jesus is also challenging a regime that is oppressive, brutal, demanding, systems, not just governments, but systems that are at work in the world that are as oppressive as indeed any Roman government ever might have been or ever was. So there are a variety of understandings of the Passion of Jesus. But what lies at the heart of each and every one of them is the selfless, humble surrender of self and life and breath for the sake of others. Whether it's the political activist who stands in front of a tank in Tiananmen Square, or someone who stands up to the brutal oppression of an army somewhere, that is part of the calling of the people of God to resist those things in this world that are brutal and violent, life-denying, life-destroying. And indeed, one could take that same understanding of that self-sacrifice and that selfless surrender to think about political things, to think about the kinds of things that political regimes on all sides of the political spectrum create and empower, and to ask whether or not those things are consonant with the value of love and care for others and surrender that lies at the heart of the Passion story and its transforming power. We can think, indeed, just as the earliest Christians who were Jewish, we can think about the ways in which that loving sacrifice of Jesus, that humiliating surrender of self on the cross for others in all kinds of ways saves us, because it teaches us something about our natures, but more importantly, something about what our natures could be capable of. How we might be, how we might indeed enter into that new life, that redeemed living, that significant impact, however you want to describe it, new possibilities, enabling us and empowering us to create the kind of good world that God did intend in the very beginning. Heart of it is love. The heart of it always is love. That's the power behind the transformations. That's the power that allows people to recognize Jesus as Savior and Messiah on Palm Sunday, to be disappointed by what happens on Good Friday, but be open to the power of that love with what will happen on Easter. So as we think about the Passion of Jesus this week, and we will focus more particularly on different aspects of today's reading on Thursday night, on Friday morning, and indeed we'll add another bit to it next Sunday morning. We always need to embrace and remember that what transforms all of this isn't power that's indifferent to humans, isn't power that's at some kind of distance from us, that what unleashes the power of the gospel and the transforming power of Jesus is the love that he gives and demonstrates and shares to the very end of his human existence. And through that same love and the power of the Holy Spirit is called to new life as Christ, the risen Christ. That love is the currency of our hearts. As we go through Holy Week, let us all think about that.
Passion Sunday, when as Canadians we remember that 100 years ago, a bunch of youngsters from all over a largely rural country traveled across oceans to fight people they didn't even know because they were doing it out of love for their country, for their families, for their friends, for the good work that they helped to achieve, for the peace that their sacrifice helped to bring, however temporary. We need to remember that they too were powered by love. And so I think one last thing we need to think about and remember is at the heart of suffering, whatever it may be, however difficult it may be to experience or to watch or to observe or to respond to, at the heart of that is love. That indeed, through the power of love, even the worst kind of suffering is a little transformed, and if not relieved, at least given some kind of meaning that makes it bearable. In this Passion Tide, this Holy Week, I ask you in your prayers to think about all the ways in which your love could be experienced or shared with those around you, in the name of Jesus. On this Passion Sunday, we give thanks for the loving self-sacrifice and suffering of Jesus. And we pray for all who suffer and are struggling with violence, injustice, pain, addiction, or disease. Help us to respond with understanding, forgiveness, and compassion.
Kirk Herter, John Beck,
Christ and our Redeemer.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
my brothers and sisters in Christ, the love and peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share with our immediate neighbors the sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you. God, creator of heaven and earth, we give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, who for our sins was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. By his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore, with all the hosts of heaven, who gather around your throne and the Lamb, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of life where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as Jesus, our brother and our Savior, commanded and taught us, we're bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread. Communion in Christ's body once broken. Let your church be the wheat which bears its fruit in dying. We have died with him.
We shall live with him. If we hold firm, we shall reign with him.
My sisters and brothers in Christ, see what you are and become what you receive. These are the gifts of God for you, the holy and beloved people of God.
Thanks be to God.
palm tree folded into crosses, and grant that what your people show today physically for your honor, they may perform spiritually with great devotion and ardently loving good works through Jesus Christ, our Lord.